First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me. And Ambassador Sikri, the answer to what you asked me has already been given by Nitin at the beginning of the panel. The answer is India first. I think that it's very important for us to recognize what we can do, and to recognize whether we have the resources, the ability to do what we want to do or not. But in the speculation and the discussions that have been going on in the past 2.5 years, the India-United States relationship has been focused on as a hedge or a pillar for India in the context of a reassertive China. And I thought that it was useful for me to take this and to go back a little bit into the India-United States relationship in terms of the concept that we are natural allies. I mean, that is where I would like to start with. And that begins on September 2000 when Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee uses this term in the Asia Society in New York. And he says India and the United States are natural allies. Our many shared values provide the foundation for it. Our many common interests in the region demand it from us. And then he goes on to make the linkage that India's security, stability, and prosperity are central to the security, stability, democracy, and prosperity in Asia. The initiatives we take will uphold all India values and symbolizes. And I'd like to really emphasize, what does India symbolize? What are these Indian values? Because in the discourse that's going on, we have no reference at all to what is the Indian contribution in terms of both the aspects that Atal Bihari Vajpayee talked about, the shared values and the shared interests. Now, the shared values, I would put in 3 bullets, democracy and equal participation in decision making. This is what links India and the United States together. A common commitment to individual liberty and a common commitment to freedom of expression and religion. Now, this was used in the year 2000. In 2018, the world has changed. The United States itself appears to have changed. So the first question is, does the United States today share similar values with India or not? And that is, I think, something that we need to look at. The interests are more consistent. They were the same in 2000. They are the same today. Stability and predictability based on rule of law and rule of international law and security, and probably the most important, as we are seeing with the visit of the president's son to India now, economic growth and prosperity, market access, and here I would add, including movement of technology, capital, and people. Now, these are the 5 basic issues on which the India-United States natural ally relationship are predicated. And just to illustrate what this government has been doing to carry, to bring this to the forefront. On the left, you have this whole thing of Indian tea thrown into the Boston Harbor, but the principle of no taxation without representation, which translates in today's terms in international relations as equal say in decision making. We are not in any way, as India first, going to accept decisions made for us by others, no matter how well-meaning or how friendly they may be. The second is an affirmation of India's democracy, and that was Mr. Modi receiving this copy of the telegram, a copy of the telegram of 1946 to India's Constituent Assembly sent by the United States. The fact that the constitutions are based on a similar worldview, a similar shared values, is something that we need to actually look at, because we are aware, sitting in India today, of what is happening to the Constitution in the United States. The second is the shared values, the spiritual values. And I think it's very important, because in the discourse we have, even when we talk of China, we do not bring this dimension into the discourse. We talk of an alliance of democracies. We talk of a linkage between like-minded countries like the United States and India. We have shared values of, say, tolerance, universal acceptance. We have shared values of non-violence, which Mr. Modi reaffirmed when he catalyzed the relationship with Barack Obama standing in front of the Martin Luther King statue. If you remember, that was the defining moment when Barack Obama agreed to come as chief guest to our Republic Day parade in 2015. But this was the moment when it happened, according to all informed experts. Now, these are the values which underpin the relationship. And the question I would like to pose is, do these values retain their validity under Donald Trump or not? And I think that this is a very important question to keep in mind when we look at the countering of the Chinese assertions in Asia by using the India-United States relationship. Because if the India-United States relationship for some reason cannot rely on the shared values, then we are only looking at the transactional nature of the India-United States relationship. And where does that place India first is the question that I'd like to ask. Now, there are other elements of India-United States relations which have not been talked about. Anirban and I have talked a little about Pondicherry, about how the daughter of President Woodrow Wilson, who did not want India in the League of Nations, but his daughter traveled to India, became a follower of Sri Aurobindo, and spent the last years of her life and is buried in Pondicherry. There is similarly another president, Roosevelt, who brought India into the United Nations. His wife came to India and wrote this book, India and the Awakening of the East. Now again, something that links to the common people, to the spiritual thing. And most recently, Steve Jobs, all of you have got Apple phones and so on. Steve Jobs, when he knew he was going to die, he decided how his funeral would be conducted. And in that funeral, every guest was given one brown box which contained a book. The book was Autobiography of a Yogi by Paramahansa Yogananda. And this whole thing of the yogi, the reference was made to the Yoga Day. But this is something that linked the India-US natural alliance with the spiritual dimension. Today, unfortunately, we are not able to speak about all these matters because of other reasons. Now, I mentioned President Roosevelt and how, despite the opposition of Winston Churchill, he invited India to join the 26 countries who launched the United Nations on the 1st of January 1942. This is a historical photograph. That blue arrow is above Sir Girija Shankar Bajpai, who was the agent general or the envoy of India to Washington, D.C. He signed this document calling for the United Nations. And at that time, the United Nations had an alliance of 26 countries which included the Republic of China, not the Communist Chinese, but the Republic of China. And as part of this, for those of you from the Indian Army, you would know it very well, at Ramgarh, in the regimental training center in Ramgarh, the first base was established at which Chinese soldiers who were retreating from the Japanese in Burma were brought here, because most of them were conscripts, and they were trained by American instructors and sent back into the theater, to use that word, theater. And most of them were deployed in the construction of the Stillwell Road, which links Ledo in Assam to Kunming in China. So this is the kind of India-United States history, even from the defense perspective. Now to move from that into the second stage, which is the Indo-Pacific region and the resurgent India. Now, I have consciously used this map, which is a colonial map. It has no Pakistan in it, and it has none of these other things that have happened in the 20th century in it. But it is important. It is important to keep this map in mind because of one reason, and that is, what is India's role in the Indo-Pacific? Now, I have been going through a lot of literature, listening to a lot of speeches on the Indo-Pacific, and we have, with very, very valid reasons, focused on the South China Sea. We have even reached the Straits of Malacca. But then, Admiral Harris, who till recently was the commander of the U.S. Pacific Command in Hawaii, when he propagated the Indo-Pacific very consistently over the last 5 or 6 years before his now appointment as ambassador to Australia, he stopped short at the western coast of India. And he stopped short at the western coast of India because of one reason, which I think our strategic community needs to really look at head on. And that is that the area of responsibility of the Pacific Command of the United States stops at the port of Mumbai and the west coast of India. It does not go into the Pakistan and Afghanistan and the Gulf, etc., the western Indo-Pacific, which is part of the U.S. Central Command area of responsibility. And I mention this because today, with a transactional India-United States relationship, we are dependent on three key advisors of President Donald Trump on how to deal with India and the Indo-Pacific. And all three are generals of the United States Armed Forces who have served in the Central Command. None of them have served in the Pacific Command. I think that's a very important issue, which is a small footnote, but for those of us in this room who are from the armed forces, you would appreciate how important that will be in how the expectations we have of the United States in countering China will be met on the ground. Because this is something that will be met in a very critical way. Now, to come back, for many years, and I'm now glad that finally we have reached the end of this process, for many years, the India-United States relationship was supposed to be the great nuclear, civilian nuclear agreement. Now, at the end of the day, nothing has happened and nothing is likely to happen because the company which was to build it has gone bankrupt, Westinghouse. And so, therefore, you will not have nuclear reactors in India built by the United States. But what you will have, and I think that's the important part of the nuclear deal, is the technologies. The technologies, because the core of the nuclear deal was to give India access to dual-use technologies. And what are the sectors where these technologies are to be acquired by India? Apart from nuclear materials, facilities, and equipment, which was part of the nuclear energy part, they include chemicals, electronics, computers, telecommunications, sensors and lasers, as well as navigation and avionics equipment. And this, I would argue, is central to the Indian role in the Indo-Pacific project, which we have talked about earlier today, the maritime domain, the Indian Ocean, etc. And central to that, and I think what we need to do with our American friends is to bring to the table what is India's policy as announced by this government with regard to the maritime domain, the Western Indo-Pacific region. This is the policy of security and growth for all, or SAGAR, which has five main points. One, India is a net security provider. Second, India is a contributor to enhance maritime security capacities. Third, collective action to respond to challenges from the maritime domain. Fourth, which is something completely out of the picture in a discussion of this kind, the sustainable development issues, including the blue or ocean economy, which has featured in the Indian Ocean conferences held in the last 2 years. And fifth, and that's an important point for India first, is that the primary responsibility for peace, stability, and prosperity of our region is on the countries of our region. External cooperation is essentially meant for capacity building and economic partnership. Now, having said that, what are the four priorities for us in the Indo-Pacific region? One, which has been talked of in the morning, sea lanes of communication. But here I am adding the choke points of the Red Sea, the Bab al-Mandab and the Red Sea, the Hormuz Straits, as well as the Straits of Malacca. The discourse has always been on South China Sea and Straits of Malacca. I have not heard much about the Bab al-Mandab and the Red Sea, nor have I heard so much about Hormuz. But both of these sea lanes of communication are critical for India's resurgence and for India's transformation. The second, something that we do not hear about, and probably is because we have decided to isolate Pakistan, but the fact remains that every day, 5 to 7 Indian soldiers are being impacted by terrorism coming from across the border. Now, when will we restore this issue back to the table? We cannot afford to ignore the fact that while we deal with an assertive China and all that they will do to us, how many Indian soldiers are being killed by the Chinese on the border every day, and how many soldiers are being killed by the Pakistanis every day? That is something that has to come back onto the table, and it has to come back in India-United States engagement on the Indo-Pacific, because the Americans have some levers which they can use in the AFPAC region, which we do not know whether they will use in the interests of India. The third, which has been demonstrated most recently by Mr. Modi's visit to West Asia, stability in the Gulf. And the fourth is the implementation of the SAGAR policy. So, before I conclude, there's another dimension to the India-United States relationship which needs to be factored into any discussion we have on our common cooperation in the maritime domain of the Indo-Pacific, and that is the cyber domain. Now, I have just put, just for an illustration, the Asia-Africa-Europe connection. This is the cable, the fiber optic cable, that connects us as a digital economy to the rest of the global digital economy. As you will see, this cable runs through, it doesn't stop at the western coastline of India, although Admiral Harris may have thought that it should stop there. It goes beyond, it goes through Djibouti, it goes through the Suez Canal, and it goes all the way to France and Italy. And I think that if we do not bring in or expand the scope of the Indo-Pacific to include issues like countering terrorism, to include issues like cybersecurity, then we will not be able to ensure that India First's interests will be met by this enterprise of the Indo-Pacific project. Now, in answer to the Quad, I find, you know, the Quad is an interesting idea, but look at the answer given by the government in the Rajya Sabha on 4th of January. Government on the Quad. The government has recently engaged with Australia, Japan, and the United States in a plurilateral consultation on issues of common interest in the Indo-Pacific region. We have discussed exploring practical steps to enhance cooperation on issues of common interest. So far, it's all diplomatic, non-statement, including areas, now three areas, maritime security, proliferation, and counterterrorism. So maritime security, we are aware. We know what has been happening, including the enhanced Malabar exercises. Proliferation so far has been on North Korea because of the interests of the other three members. But what about proliferation from Pakistan and what they are doing? We do not know. And counterterrorism, I think, actually has really not been addressed head on. Now, the answer to this question about the Quad and India and all that, I think the answer is very clear. The relationship between Japan, Australia, and the United States is a military alliance relationship. The Japan and the United States have a treaty from 1960, which has been upgraded in 2015, which is the cornerstone of U.S. security interests in Asia. Australia is part of the U.S.-Australia-New Zealand Security Treaty of 1951, and under both treaties, they have regular consultations, including on policy as well as on implementation of policy, which includes issues like interoperability of equipment and so on, of communications and so on. Now, all three of them engage in a trilateral security dialogue. So far, India does not feature as a military ally of the United States, and therefore, in terms of Quad, we have a mismatch. Now, how we handle this mismatch is something that the strategic community and the government would have to deal with, but the fact remains that we are not on the same level as Japan and Australia vis-a-vis the United States through the Quad. And the point here to make again is the same, that if we are not equal participants in decision-making, then we are not going to ensure India First in the Quad. So that is what I'd like to say and end with this lovely photograph of our Prime Minister in the United States, who says a strong India-US partnership can anchor peace, prosperity, and stability from Asia to Africa and from the Indian Ocean to the Pacific. So that was probably the Indo-Pacific, but it needs all the issues that I've talked about. Thank you.